So yeah. So Angie or Al? Al, I think. Is Al come up here? Al, just Al. Just saying. Ian Allen. So yeah. Yes. Yes, absolutely. Awesome. Thank you. Thank you. Yes. Make checks out to Destiny Church. Yes. All right. So we got some people up there to ask some questions. So what's a question that you have a question on that you want to ask? Something you might be lingering in on your heart. Yeah. Not all at once. Not all at once. See me ask a question. Start with that. Yes, Pastor Tim, yes.
Yes, I have a question. I wasn't here last night, so maybe you covered this, but the idea about all the pronouns and you know, they're a girl, but they want to be addressed as a guy. Is it wrong to address them according to their biological birth? Or what should we do there?
You know, I think a lot. Okay, so I'm going to lean on Laura Perry. So Laura Perry is an ex-trans, and she always has said that her mother would not call her by he. She would not call her Jake. She always called her Laura. And in her book, she says that always tethered me to the truth. And just like Rocio said, I never call my daughter the pronoun she wants. And I never call her by the name that she desires. But I'm tethering her to the truth. But these are relationships that they have with, obviously, their daughters. So it becomes a little different when you're working with the general public. So I don't use the pronouns that they want me to. I will say friend. I will use something very generic, but I will never, because I have such a strong conviction. I'm an all or nothing person. I'll just be honest with you. I know, hard to believe. So I will not do it. So I will with kindness, I've told people I hear what you're saying, but I will refer to you as friend during this conversation.
And I'll just say, you know, I actually received a correction from the Lord about this in a prayer meeting, because we have a prayer meeting twice a month for the ministry, and we were praying for Richard Levine, who is the Biden's number two for Secretary of Health and Human Services. Well, as you know, Richard is a trans woman and goes by Rachel. So we're in this prayer meeting, and I'm praying for Rachel Levine. It was a beautiful prayer. You know, Lord, save Rachel. I don't remember what I was saying. But I paused for a minute, and the Lord, I mean, it was just like, he was right here. He said, who's that?
Come on.
And I was like, I was like, oh Lord, like Richard Levine. I pray for Richard Levine. So that, I mean, up until that point, it really took the Lord to like get in my face. Like, I don't know who that is.
I think for our ministry, Sarah and I even come from a different perspective. I'm probably lean more towards Angie and Nate, but I think we as a ministry also talk about how, particularly in this generation, our lower generation, we want to build relationships with them. We don't want to drive them away. And if pronouns is where they're going to end all relationship with us, if we don't know them, and it ends communication and we can no longer speak truth into their life in other ways, then are we willing to sacrifice that so that we can move along in the relationship and show them Jesus in a different way. God is more powerful than anything. God is more powerful than sharing a different name, telling them a different name. God can overcome that, okay? So that's where kind of our ministry comes from. We want to keep relationships alive. So if we have to sacrifice on that a little bit, we believe God can overcome that.
I know for me, I work at a large national corporation where there's a lot of transgender, and you know, we've got one person, actually a couple that I work with, but one that I've kind of gotten to know a little bit, and I just don't even use the name, because to be honest, I have the greatest excuse, I don't remember names. So I'm just, you know, as they're walking by, I'm like, hey, how's it going? And, you know, we just have a fun conversation without ever even pulling up names, thank God.
I think I would also just add that you have to have that relationship with the Lord. What does the Lord want you to do in that relationship? You have to have that communication with him.
Yeah. I was going to say there's really a spirit of confusion on this whole thing. So like, if they introduce them, they're looking like a guy and they introduce themselves with a guy's name. And sometimes I don't even know that they're transgendered because they look just like a guy. And then I find out later that they've transgendered. But if I don't stick with one pronoun, I'm going to keep on messing up all the time because there's a spirit of confusion on it because they look like a guy, they say their guy's name. And so for me personally, I stick with what they introduce themselves as, and I consider it a temporary condition. Like, this is not who they are, this is not who they will be, because in heaven we're going to get a new name written on a white stone. So it's even our names are going to be changed in heaven, right? And when they come to the Lord, then these things will all drop away. So I just consider it a temporary condition, then I continue to want to have relationship, and otherwise they'll cut you off in like less than 5 minutes and you won't have any relationship. That doesn't do any good. Because the soul is more important than names and pronouns and all that. You have to get deeper down to touch their soul, which is what Jesus died for.
I just had a question for all of you. We're talking about the women at the well and just that love. Do you feel like in each one of your situations, was it more about the love and the relationship that you had with the people that drew you back? Or was it more of the truth, or did the truth kind of like offend you? I'm thinking about, you know, ministering to people, thinking about people who are raised in the church, you approach them different than people that have never heard the truth, and how, you know, what brings that back. And I know it's probably situation by situation, but I imagine we have to approach it more of if they have known the truth in the past, it's been part of it, or they've never been encountered the truth.
I think what our ministry talks about is creating connections with people, particularly through empathy, and that's a place of listening and caring for people and not having an answer or trying to find the silver lining in their pain. So I think in my story, when my dad, as I was starting to walk out of the LGBT community, he would invite me to lunch, and then we would go for a walk, and I would tell him the things that I was dealing with at the time. And then at the beginning, I didn't share a whole lot. But as I saw that I could trust him, because he continued to pursue me in relationship and showed empathy and listening to me, I trusted him more and I shared more. And so I think that is where we need to start, is in building connection building that relationship. And for those that knew Jesus or know Jesus and have walked away, we need to restart that relationship in connection with them first. And then from that place of connection and love, we can share the truth. They're in a better place to hear the truth when they know they can trust you. So that's, I think, where I would say that.
Yeah. That's really good. You know, I think sometimes we feel like we have to play Holy Spirit in people's lives. And you know what? We can free ourselves up because that's not our job.
Mine's more about legal issues. My brother's a professor at UNK, and they have been told that they have to use gender preferred pronouns and everything. And you had said, you or Courtney did in the last session, that legally that's not binding. So that's part one of that question. Is it legally binding when it's through a university? And then the Equality Act, what does that speak to, the whole issue of freedom of speech in those areas? I know that's kind of, but I just need clarity.
Even though they're state funded.
I would say it is.
Legally binding.
They
could lose their job.
Absolutely.
Okay.
I would, that wouldn't be surprised at all if that's how it was. Mm-hmm. And not just because of the legality, but because of the policies on college campuses. The Equality Act, I mean, this is pretty exhaustive, and the things that it would change, the things that it would shift. Were you in my workshop when I talked about the transition from sexual orientation to biological? No, okay. So probably one of the biggest shifts that would happen if the Equality Act were to become the law of the land is that they would make a shift from, at this point, a church or a religious organization can discriminate on the basis of sexual orientation, but they cannot discriminate in hiring on the basis of sex. So the example would be if you have a church secretary position that you are advertising for, and you know a homosexual applies for the job, as a church you could say, I'm sorry, we love you, but we can't hire you because we don't employ homosexuals. What a church can't do from a legal perspective is say, I'm sorry, I can't hire you because you're a woman and we don't hire women. You know, so I mean, there's some distinction there. The trans issue is what really muddies the waters, because they would change the definition from, for a trans person, that wouldn't be under the umbrella of sexual orientation, it would be under the umbrella of biological sex. And so now, if you have a church secretary position and a trans woman applies for the job, legally you wouldn't be able to not hire her because of that. It would be sexual discrimination. So, I mean, that in and of itself is a profound shift for the church from a legal perspective. It would also limit the things that we could say from the pulpit regarding transformation. And there's a couple ways that they're coming at this. One of the probably most insidious is they're adding consumer fraud clauses to some of the legislation. So they're saying if you tell people that Jesus can transform them at a Christian conference, in a Christian book, anything like that, where there's money exchanged, even to the point where, you know, they're even saying this could extend to you're giving an offering on Sunday morning, you can be sued for consumer fraud because, you know, the psychological association, all these places tell you that that's not possible. So you're trying to sell something that is fraudulent. And if you think that that's not going to happen, it's already happened in the United States, there was a ministry called Jonah. Actually, it was a Jewish ministry, and they were sued and they lost, and they got him on the consumer fraud thing. So there's so much in this Equality Act that is just, I mean, it's really insidious. Do you want to add anything?
And just know that before Biden leaves office, this is really going to be pushed and hammered. And it's written so that legally they don't have to tell anybody. So it could be a middle of the night thing that occurs. But there has been a lawsuit filed against the Equality Act, and it's a bunch of ex-gays that have gotten together to file this. So pray for that. Pray that what is in there is exposed, because again, we have language that sounds good, that sounds protective, that's inclusive. So we just really need to be wise about that. I have an article here that I've written called The Nail in the Coffin, and it's about the Equality Act. So if you would like that, it gives you information about it and what we can do as churches to get ready, you know, in our bylaws, in our statement of faith. And that might, the Equality Act might super exceed anything bylaws that are written.
I thought of something. Yeah, right. And now I forgot it, so.
Hello.
I want to take a different perspective, maybe take a left turn on this. Our ministry, we tend to try to stay a little bit out of the political stuff, but I would want to mention that, particularly for me, I've thought about this and prayed about it, and the Lord has always highlighted to me, where there's persecution, the church grows. China, Africa, Central, South America, those are some of the biggest church growth that's ever happened. China particularly. China shut down its country to Christians for I don't know how many years, and when they reopened it, millions of people were Christian. How does that happen? And I'm not saying that's going to happen in America, but our ministry, we choose not to fear that. I would tell the church, don't fear it. God is stronger. God is more powerful. God will overcome it. And if the church needs to go underground, that's not new for the church. The first century Christians were underground churchgoers. They were being crucified. They were being punished by Nero and the Romans. And the church grew out of that to what we see today. So that's just my left turn on that conversation.
I do. I remembered and then I forgot it. And I remembered all in the course of that. No, I'm going to say it right now. It's been a long day. I do want to tell you that when it was announced that Biden was rewriting Title IX, there was a petition that went out, and it was one of the largest signed petitions, and that made an impact. So, they took a step back, and now they're rewriting it again. But that was encouraging to me that, because there was this overwhelming response from people just like you, that worked. So we can continue to be good citizens. Other questions? Shout it out. Thank you, God. That's the Lord. But it not. Yes, it's the Lord. And it's the tools that the Lord has given me to maintain joy. And particularly in the last, I would say, 4 or 5 years, I was introduced to a model for inner healing called the Emmanuel Approach. And, you know, I've done a lot of different kinds of training in inner healing, but the Emmanuel Approach was based on brain science and how we can build new neurology for joy. And it was probably one of the most life-changing things that I've learned in the last two decades. And so a lot of the tools that, you know, I've learned through that have, I think, sparked new joy in me and helped me to maintain joy even in difficult circumstances, because things are getting darker and more difficult, and we do experience warfare and suffering and all of those things. So, you know, that's something I can definitely point you towards and, you know, give you more information about. You know, how do we build new connections and neural pathways in our brains so that we can always return to joy? That's been a big thing in my life. So yeah, give me your email. We'll connect. Yeah.
I think for myself is the setting of my heart, the positioning of my heart, and you know, we talk about a lot about partnershiping with him and his leadership. And oftentimes in prayer, it's just, I love your leadership. And then I read scriptures like from Hebrews that talks about the joy set before him. And I'm like, God, I want to carry my heart the way you carry your heart. So teach me how to do that. Teach me. And sometimes I do get discouraged. So then I have intercessors around me. I have a best friend that I go to and I say, you know, and even my husband, you know, you've got to set, my heart's not right. It needs to be set on the path of joy. Can you just listen to me and then pray with me about what's going on? So, Sherry, it's you finding those people that are going to fight and contend with you, but then pray for you, and then you saying, for the joy set before me. And knowing that what we go through is never in vain. Like, I mean, for me, that I could breathe, because when you're going through, it's heavy. When you're going through, it hurts, and there's pain. And I'm like, this is not in vain. This is for glory. And we're moving from glory to glory. And then my bigger picture, which I know yours is too, who's underneath me? And oftentimes when you are the first one to go through, when you are the tip of the arrow, when you are the plow, it is hard. But from glory to glory for his kingdom. And just asking him, set my heart on joy. Because I want joy everlasting.
I thought of a couple things. And I don't know if they're really biblical things, but in a way they are. I could figure out a way to connect it back to the Bible. First thing that popped in my head was and joy and our finding joy in the suffering and all that. Just being able to laugh and laugh at myself when I've made mistakes. I can look at my past and I'm like, oh man, that was dumb. And I can laugh about it. Even when I was in the lifestyle, I was like, I would not do that now. That's dumb. And I can laugh about it, and that's good. And we need to be able to continue to laugh. Which is somewhat sad in our culture because we're taking away the things that we can laugh about. And then on top of that, I love Tolkien and Lord of the Rings because he was such a great storyteller when it comes to journeys and adventures. And that's how I really feel my life is and my journey through homosexuality and in my marriage is a journey. Every time Sarah and I go on a trip, whether it's to ministry or here, we say to each other, I think it's time for another adventure. And that's how we choose to tackle our difficulties. It's just another adventure. So before I came here, I lost my wallet the night before. I don't know where it's at. And I had it the next day, we kind of scrambled to get me an ID and a new debit card. And I could either choose to just sit and wallow and be like, why me, Lord? Or kind of laugh it off and be like, it's time for another adventure. This is part of the adventure. We're just going to keep going. And part of that adventure that, again, Tolkien did so well with is that there are people around him, people around the adventure. It wasn't just Frodo going by himself. He had Sam with him. And it wasn't just Aragorn. He had Gimli and Legolas with him. And that's important. We don't do it alone. So that's where I find joy.
I'll be your Samwise.
So you're Frodo.
So in my head. So
you're Aragorn. No, you like to be Aragorn. Yeah, yeah, there you go.
Okay, so moving on. I'm Princess Leia to Luke Skywalker. Okay. Whew, I had to find my place. Anyway, but I want to talk about something that Nate brought up last night, and that's suffering. And the long suffering that we often have to endure with people that come out of this lifestyle, because because a lot of you are going to encounter this when your son and daughter comes out, is the suffering part of it. So I want Nate to start and Ian to start, and then I'll give my response, and then we'll call it a day.
Well, you know, we've said it a lot. This is a front lines issue. And so, you know, there's a lot of different ways that we experience spiritual warfare, and that the people coming out of same-sex attractions experience spiritual warfare. So I've primarily worked with youth and young adults for all these years, and I know when I first sit down with that young person, maybe they're 13, 14, 16, whatever, I know that I'm signing up for a very long journey. And it's ups and downs and valleys, and it's a journey like Ian was talking about. And there are victories and failures, and it's back and forth. And especially, you know, I mean, that's how any high school kid is anyway. Right? But I have to tell you, it's worth it showing up day in, day out. It's worth it. I worked with this young man. Oh my gosh, he was in high school. I mean, probably throughout a lot of his high school years. And he was, you know, he was there at times when he was doing really well, and then at times when he was not doing well, and then he would be sneaking around, and his parents would find out. I mean, all this kind of stuff. And then, like, he graduated, and he went into the military, and I didn't really hear much from him, but he was doing very well in the military. And then one day, out of the blue, he was going to West Point, and he showed up at my office, like, in his army uniform, you know, like, all dressed up, and he showed up to say thank you. I was like, oh my goodness. I mean, like, you know, like, that was, he'd become a man, you know. I'm working with a young girl right now who came in, and she identifies as a non-binary, and I've been working with her for several years, and it's been slow. It's been a slow process. But in you know, when she came in, she thought she had all these tics, and she was booping and bopping, and I just sit with her, and we kept working through things. Those went away, and you know, she has all these diagnoses that she gives herself, so those went away. And then I'd say, oh, well, whatever happened to those tics? Oh, they're still there. Okay, well, whatever. But you know, she slowly, over time, the plane is leveling, and she said the other day, you know, it's actually been a fairly good year, and that's largely because of what you're doing. And I was like, oh my gosh. Now, she still identifies as non-binary, but again, slowly over time. Now, this is exhausting to do this, Like, you know, I want to be like, hey, come on, let's. I got other people to meet with. You know, let's go here. But I just have to remind myself, you know, it's the long suffering that really matters. It's the showing up every day, and it's becoming a safe, secure place for them. You know, they have to securely attach to me. I have to let that happen. I have to become a secure attachment, and that is a profound honor that, you know, they're giving me, and I can't betray that. So I have to become that person that maybe other people weren't able to be for them. That means that they're taking something from me, you know, and I'm pouring myself out, and but it's worth it. It's worth it.
When I think about suffering in my journey, when I was thinking about it, the first thing that popped in my head was C.S. Lewis talking about how he came into the kingdom of God kicking and screaming. Now, I didn't lead the homosexual lifestyle kicking and screaming. It was a good thing that I did leave it. I didn't want to stay there anymore. But through that process, it was a struggle to leave that behind. Every time that I chose to, in my week, yes, say yes to Jesus, or I was telling Sarah a couple nights ago, it was a reluctant yes. I didn't want to say yes. Every time I did that, Jesus would meet me. Jesus would come. He proved himself worth trusting every step. And sometimes I would trust him weeks or months or a couple of hours, but he took whatever he could, and he was patient. And my suffering, it was patience that helped me walk through it. And so for me, when I started walking out of homosexuality, I chose to pursue holy sexuality or a holy lifestyle, a lifestyle that is separate from the world. Is really what it means. And it was hard. I had to spiritually, and in some cases physically, kill spiritually things I wanted to do. I had to say no to certain things that I really desired to do. And in that process, so much growth, so much spiritual connection has grown in its place. My relationship with Jesus has grown deeper. My relationship with people has grown deeper. My family has grown deeper, my wife. It grows deeper every time I say no to myself and say yes to them and say yes to God. It just grows deeper. It just becomes better. It seems odd. Yeah, I think part of my suffering was having to say no to things, and it was good. My generation and below doesn't know how to suffer. We don't know how to face the hard things head on. And I was a part of that. And once I saw that, just little things to start, that it was better that I lived without this, or I was better without this. I went through a season where I didn't watch TV, and my life was better. Sarah and I got married. We decided not to have social media anymore. Our life is 1,000% better. I do not miss Twitter. I do not miss Facebook. One of our things, if we don't even watch the news, we think that if something big enough happens, we will hear it from someone. Somebody will tell us. And I work in the public school system, and I hear a lot of things that are happening. So I don't need to hear the news. So I want to say my generation, they don't know how to suffer. And being discipled well, like Nate does and Angie does, I'll throw my dad into that. Just being discipled well with a lot of patience and kindness and empathy, it's not an overnight fix. There's a lot of pain that we have to work through, and it doesn't come all at once, and we don't understand it all at once. Like my new journey that I'm going on, I don't understand what happened to me when I was little, but I need to walk through it.
Suffering's hard because it's suffering. But I've always been intrigued by something that International House of Prayer said, and it's called the Fellowship of Suffering. And when I heard that phrase probably early in the 2000s, I was gripped. And to be honest with you, I'm an intercessor at heart. I'd rather not be here in front of you all. I'd rather be in a room with Jesus crying out for a generation and just fighting in that place. That's what I long to do. I can't wait for when I get back home, I drop my kids off at school, and Mama's going to go pray. I'm an intercessor at heart. So I've come into this knowledge of this fellowship of suffering, and we do it with him. And I just remember when he's in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he says, who's going to take this cup of suffering? And ultimately, he does, but he's asking us to do the same, to join in. And that means laying stuff down that we love. Like when I left my lover, it was excruciating. I didn't know what would happen to her. I thought she would die. I'd shrivel up because I kept her alive. That's literally what I thought in my head. You know, a lot of people in this situation think that about the person they're with. But God was very stern with me. He said, do you not trust me with even her? And I said, well, yeah, of course I do, but I've kind of helped her all these years, you know, because I'm such a good influence. God. You know, it's so ridiculous. But I just handed her over, and I cut all ties, and I haven't spoken to her ever since I left that night, you know. But I just, where am I going with that? But like Ian was saying, this is something, we don't sign up for suffering, but the Lord asks us to take those things that we so desire and to have them crucified. You know, that the instrument of death is the cross, and he asks us to take it up every day. And then I began to read scripture. It says the way is narrow and very difficult. You know, I thought once I was in, and, you know, the way is difficult. And he's asked us to, if you want to know me, and he wants friendship with all of us in this room, but very many few people will get there with him in friendship because they don't want to suffer. And I remember one theologian says, this is how you treat your friends. Why would anybody want to be friends with you, Jesus? If it hurts this much, or if I have to suffer this much, if I have to give up this much, why would anybody be your friend? And that statement has gripped me, and I've always told the Lord, I want friendship with you. I know you as Lord and Savior. I know you as King. I know you as lover. I know you as husband. I want to know friendship with you. And that means if we enter into that friendship with him, there is suffering. Because I'm saying no to a lot of other things. But it stirs me from deep within. So when I left this lifestyle, like I said before, I'm an all or nothing person. And so sometimes these decisions are very hard, are very easy, and I'm just all in. But sometimes they're very agonizing because I know what the cost is and I know what I have to get up. And I'm not really good at prying my hands off of things. But when he starts to peel my fingers back, I'm like, okay, God, I'm letting go. So I close with that.
When you were talking about suffering, and you actually mentioned that scripture, there is a devotional by Oswald Chambers. It's June 25th, Receiving Yourself in the Fires of Sorrow. And it uses that scripture, what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. Before this purpose, I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. As a saint of God, my attitude towards sorrow and difficulty should not be to ask that they be prevented, but to ask that God protect me so that I may remain what he created me to be in spite of all my fires of sorrow. I was raised in a human trafficking ring, and when I read that it was possible the idea that it was possible for God, for me to face the sorrow and suffering that happened in my life. I didn't think that it was possible to face that kind of sorrow and that kind of suffering the way I needed to in order to heal and still come out alive. But when I read that and it said, ask that God protect me so that I may remain what he created me to be in spite of all my sorrows, it gave me the ability to take the next step. It says, he was not saved from the hour, but out of the hour. We say that there ought to be no sorrow, but there is sorrow, and we have to accept and receive ourselves in its fires. If we try to evade sorrow, refusing to deal with it, we are foolish. Sorrow is one of the biggest facts in life, and there is no use in saying it should not be. Sin, sorrow, and suffering are, and it is not for us to say that God has made a mistake in allowing them. That was hard for me. Sorrow removes a great deal of a person's shallowness, but it does not always make that person better. Sorrow either gives me to myself or it destroys me. You cannot find or receive yourself through success because you lose your head over pride. And you cannot receive yourself through the daily monotony of your daily life because you give in to complaining. The only way to find yourself is in the fires of sorrow. Why it should be this way is immaterial. The fact is that it is true in the scriptures and in human experience. This is the part that gave me a lot of hope, that if I just keep going, here's the promise. You can always recognize who has been through the fires of sorrow and received himself, and you know that you can go to him in your moment of trouble and find that he has plenty of time for you. But if a person has not been through the fires of sorrow, he is apt to be contemptuous, having no respect or time for you, only turning you away. If you will receive yourself in the fires of sorrow, God will make you nourishment for other people.
Amen. Right. Well, I just want to personally thank you for coming to this conference. I hope and pray that God has downloaded something into your spirit that will change, one, yourself, two, your family, and three, a city and a region. And just, I know it's been like a hydrant today turned on and you're gulping for air, but just ask the Lord, what can I glean from this and what are you asking of me? And he'll tell you. So I personally want to thank you. I know that the stuff that we present and what we confront is not easy, and it's easy things to deal with. But we have to start dealing with this at a level, because people need it, and people need to be transformed, and they need to hear the truth. At the end of February, we will be in Columbus. So if you want to come to Word of Life, it's always a good time with good food. I hope to have Laura Perry there and some of the people that were here today, Nate and Ian. So come to that. It's a really, really cool time. And we just thank you. You guys made history in Grand Island this weekend by having us come. And we just say thank you. And I personally want to invest more into Destiny Church and even into your city and the region around here. So if you need anything, we're in Bellevue, Nebraska. I always tell my husband, you might get a job transfer. I am not leaving. So he knows that. I feel very called to this place, and we're going to stay for a while. God has really given me a heart for Nebraska. I'm not a Husker fan. So I just want you to know where I sit on that. I do have a sweatshirt. I do not like wearing it. Anyway. I just gonna be honest, my husband went to Goodwill and bought all the Husker stuff because you all not very good. And so it's all in the Goodwill. I think you just went while you were ahead. I'm Iowa State, not Iowa Hawkeyes. Iowa State. All right. All right, I just want to bless you on your way out. Let's pray. And if you have any questions, comments, or concerns, you know, we'll be here for probably like maybe 20 minutes, half an hour. And just go ahead and ask if you want to be put on mailing list. All our information is on there that you can sign up. If you need anything, please let us know. We are a resource. And even these guys who are up in Minnesota are willing to counsel over the phone. I meet with women a lot, and I do stuff with families. So, yes. 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 Okay, I need a person. I need a person in this area to do that. So we will talk about that. We've already done one in Columbus. But we're starting to spread them out throughout the state. And Ian and Sarah really run that arm of our ministry. They do it via Zoom. And then I go and I meet with groups on a regular basis. I'm getting ready to go to Columbus again before our conference and meet with the parents group. So just know that that's here and that's something we can do, you know. COVID taught us about Zoom meetings and Google Meets and, you know, all that Skype. Anyway, thank you. Thank you for your patience and thank you for your time. Lord, we thank you. You are Lord of all. We just praise you for what you've done this weekend, for the things that you've deposited in people in this room, Lord God. Father, you had something for everyone in this room to receive this weekend. So I'm asking that thing that you had, I'm asking that they would receive that in the depths of who they are, Lord God, that it would begin to stir them, Lord God, into deeper fellowship with you, that you give them wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, Father, that passion would begin to arise for your word and just for your kingdom. Father, I thank you for these precious ones, Lord God. I thank you for the testimonies, Lord God. I thank you for the workshops. I thank you for the listening ears, Lord God, for those who have devoured what you presented this weekend. We just ask that it would go out from the four corners of the walls, Lord God, that it would change the schools, Lord God, that it would change the government and the civil government and our state government, God. We're asking in Jesus' name. Father, we just thank you for who you are, that you are a God who pursues, that you are a God who loves us, that you are a God who chases after us, that you are a God who is intimate. You formed us with a purpose. And I pray for everyone in this room and their divine destiny that you have given them. I pray that they would lay hold of that, God, and run with it. But it all starts with a relationship with you and just loving on you, Jesus. And out of that place, they can fulfill the divine destiny you've given them. So I pray for that increase in their life. God, I pray for restoration of families. I pray for the prodigal to come home in Jesus' name. That they would come forth from the pit of destruction, from the places that they're in, that they would be like the prodigal son and notice what they're eating out of and say, my father's house has something better. Bring restoration to families. Bring forgiveness. Remove the resentment, Lord God, and the bitterness and the shame. And just bring your restoration to mom and dad, to brother and sister, to grandma and grandpa, to uncles and aunties, to cousins, God. Bring restoration to the family in America. Father, I'm asking for godly sorrow to fall on this region. That for what breaks your heart will begin to break ours, God. That we begin to see things with your eyes. And that we begin to move in that way. Jesus, we love you. And we love to be loved by you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.